up, yous! Gaz Misfit, here we go again. Hit the fucking monster den. It's us, us guys again, and we're doing this properly. Introduce yourself, me Abe.
Oh, you looking at me? I'm Monster. How you doing?
I'm Lucas Chappell, once again.
So, right, I'm going to speak louder because I've got this mask on.
And it's fucking loud as fuck.
And it's loud as fuck.
And we're on a house party as yeah. well, so...
Basically, we're having like a Friday the 13th house party. So, there's a lot of noise going on backstage. So, what we're going to do is, the idea is, we're going to talk a bit about the travelling morgue.
Break it down.
Which was awesome. And then we're going to bring a few people in, some friends, some family, and then we're going to ask them a few questions. Bearing in mind that some of these people aren't horror punk fans. So, but everyone loves a good horror movie. So we're going to be talking to these people about horror movies and what they would like to see if they ever got to see a horror punk band full of horror movie icons. So, first of all, what are we talking about?
Traveling morgue last week.
Traveling morgue. Let's break it down from the fucking start.
Well, the start.
Bring it down to when you first fucking arrived.
Turner.
It's fucking awesome.
Atmosphere was great when we turned up, buzzing, people there before the band started. Dr. Al were there having a beer in the car park. Genuinely, some of the nicest, coolest cats I've ever hung out with. Daniel Howe, big shout out to you, fucking star, really decent dude. Everyone was really welcoming. The guys from Dead Stiff were really cool. We'll get onto them in a bit because they blew us all away and we didn't know what we were expecting from them. Didn't know whether they were going to be dog shit or awesome. Turned out they were awesome, which was mint. Really been playing Dead Stiff non-stop since Travelling Morgue, so big respect for Dead Stiff. It was the first thing, it was the acoustic set, wasn't it? With
Headstone
Horrors. Bit different, again, they've not had their full band at Travelling Morgue for various reasons through no fault of their own. Again, it was entertaining, it was good, it wasn't a bad set, we really enjoyed
and
it.
And give them credit, like, you know what I mean, the two of them came out and they did the acoustic set, you know what I mean, with not much left, so you know what I mean, give them credit for that.
It's really good.
They killed it, acoustic-wise.
And then they didn't have their drummer and they made chicken salad out of chicken shit and they really, really, you know, did something good.
Listen
and it was a good warm-up as well because people were turning up and she sounds great, her voice is really good. And it got me fucking pumping for a great weekend.
Here she is.
Claude Deville. A sister from another mister. She doesn't drink, else I'll give her some I was just saying that what a brilliant way to start it with Headstone Horrors, and I think that was the perfect way. It was a light, easy acoustic step.
There
was horror.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyone that does the
distillers. Brody Dahl. Oh, imagine licking her fanny. God, she's gorgeous. Brody Dahl.
Did you just hear what he said? This man, not this man,
not
that
this
man.
This man.
That's the one I'm pointing to, because it's a bit awkward with you and backwards. While wearing a fucking mask, you're wrong. Right, so.
Brody Dahl's gorgeous.
So, after Headstone Horrors, who do we have next?
Dead Stiff. Wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
and they were badass.
Punk as fuck, fucking great.
First time they've stepped a foot out of London.
I've got both their albums
fucking
now.
Fucking awesome. I've been listening to them, they're fucking great.
Me too.
He's got a great voice.
Charisma.
I'm going to say it reminds me a bit of Prince.
Ooh. He looks a bit like Prince.
I know that's a bit of a touchy subject, but he does a little bit.
Dead Corbett.
Very Ramones stylish. Very, very good lyric writer. And I love the play on the name Dead Stiff. It's a very catchy, very funny name.
They touched on that, didn't they? Yeah, really, really good.
So, after Dead Stiff, what did we have?
I can't remember. No, it was... next on, I believe, was it not Looping To?
Yes.
That's actually the best I've seen then, with Dr. Howe coming on stage. Dr. Howe came on stage with Looping Tooth.
Did
an extended set.
Kicked ass. Were fantastic.
Best I've seen them actually.
Yeah, they get better and better. Every time I see them, they get just,
Because they've got a lot of songs that aren't on Spotify, haven't they?
No.
That they play live.
And for Tommy, who's putting on the show.
That guy.
In order not to put himself so high up a bill.
Yeah,
when he deserved to be a little bit higher, and personally myself. But to not have that arrogance to do that and to say, look, I'd rather go on early, get it out of the way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I dig that.
That's all
I'm saying is what you said before. Tommy is the fucking workhorse.
Yeah.
Cheers, Tommy. You are the man.
You're the man, Tommy.
Yeah.
Tommy. Right. So
all I'm saying is the lineup is very fucking crazy with what we're saying anyway.
Pick me.
Go on then, Clawfoot. Oh yeah, go on.
Horrorpunk Buzzcocks.
The Horrorpunk. That was Neil of Fortune's quote, wasn't
it? Yeah.
Neil of Fortune. Yeah. Mad. Awesome.
So who was after the Looping Two?
Well, I don't remember the order of what it came on, but I remember the courses were.
Recently, it's a fucked up. It's because of the interviews we did.
Pardon?
Remember you got
another drinking champagne in London last night, man, but I don't have a fucking clue I got here. The thing is about Flirting with Corpses were early on, they replaced I'll Be Damned, and that was very. For them, it was really, an honour, because they. Sammy, especially.
We picked after that.
Yeah, that was a really popular band, big audience.
Exactly.
And it's a similar audience, which is a good booking choice.
You know what I mean? We've talked before about the different styles of bands and different styles of horror.
Yeah.
And to replace somebody with that style with somebody of the same style.
The obvious choice is Flirting.
Yeah, was a very clever move.
Very clever, because you had that audience that would have been gutted otherwise.
Exactly.
It was a big audience.
Yeah, exactly.
So to pick someone with the same demographic was very clever of Tommy.
Right.
He could have done, say, Dead by Dawn, then there'd have been another Headstone Horror fan base.
Yeah,
it wouldn't have worked out.
Okay, so who was after that then?
Okay, let's touch on Flirting with Corpses again with Nicky's voice.
You want to touch Flirting with Corpses?
I want to touch on Nicky's voice.
Ooh.
And not get
Jesse
it wrong.
Jesse Bones.
Jesse Bones from Flirting with Corpses.
Here
he is.
Again.
He's not here. But, yet. But but Nicky Chatchy's voice. He's pushing it and pushing it and pushing it. From when I saw them in Valentine's Day 2014 to a couple of years later now. Really, really pushing his voice heavier. The band is a lot heavier. Sammy Hex's vocals have gone from being very deep, guttural to kind of death metal to much more higher pitch to match Nicky's, and it works. It doesn't sound juxtaposed anymore, and I just think they're pushing and pushing and pushing into be a heavier band, and I think they're getting more to that really heavy metal side of horror.
Yeah,
and they sound noticeably different than they did 6 months ago.
On stage they have a great presence.
Stop redoing your makeup. Oh, he got a bit of leather.
Yeah,
I enjoy
what they do. I do enjoy what they do. I love Sammy. World's biggest goth.
Literally biggest goth. He's 6 foot six.
Motherfucker's massive.
You're like, beast.
Hello, Tommy. How you doing? All right.
He's huge.
They're a big band. Great. And I enjoyed what they did. I only got to see a couple of minutes.
New songs as well, a lot heavier.
Yeah, but so who was after them on the bill?
Did we have? I know there's Gravedale.
Gravedale were after.
Yeah,
oh, man, they're fucking mind blowing anyway.
Gravedale. The thing is with Gravedale is they are consistently very good.
Yeah.
It's like bouncy.
Yeah,
very bouncy.
Like
very
I said,
punk.
Two people could be in the audience. 200 people could be in the audience. They're still going to have the same energy.
He can be playing Wembley Stadium or the Doghouse in Nottingham, and it's the same fucking upbeat.
Yeah.
Gets in the crowd, he's in your face,
he's lively,
blood pumping,
punk. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Really,
absolutely
really
brilliant. I mean, I can't say enough about our band, I fucking love that band. So, who are we after them?
Is that Army?
That would be Army.
Army of Walking Corpses,
Machine,
the guitarist is actually here. We're going to bring him in.
Well, while we're sort of killing time, why?
Great thing is about you guys, you can't smell him from where you are, which is good.
Yeah. So, Army, once again, awesome as normal.
Normal. Consistently good band. Again, they brought out new material, which in the same vein as Flirting is heavier than the stuff they've done before. You got Chelsea Smile, which we all know is a lot heavier than what they've been doing before.
Yeah. I need more blood.
And on the topic of Army is Machine,
who
is. You may remember we did the video last time for Bloodstock to get into the Bloodstock competition, where we came and filmed the first round. They got through, which you all know. Round two, unfortunately, clashes with Goolsby. Our girl Goolsby show in the UK on Friday. We're all going to go and see Army to support the horror scene in the UK. Machine, it's Friday, isn't it?
Friday 20th of May, the Intake Club Mansfield. It's our next shot at fame, stardom and local royalty.
What would it mean playing Bloodstock to you?
I just think it would be a nice step forward. Obviously you've got bands out there like Rob Zombie and people like that giving the horror sort of hint towards kind of metal.
Yep.
But we're a local band playing at Bloodstock. It's 10 mile up the road for us. It'd be a nice step forward and hopefully put Army on the map.
It's funny you say that because actually last year Rob Zombie was my favourite band, but my second favourite was Hell Puppets, who played, he won the competition that you're in this year.
Yeah.
And they last played year. Just before Rob Zombie. Yeah, the one that Army are in this year, the one that won it last year was Hell Puppets.
Yeah.
They were the second best band I saw and they came from the same competition that you're in now. And if it wasn't Rob Zombie, they'd probably have been the best band in the world.
You're in the same position that they were in a year ago.
So.
Yeah.
It's a great competition to get into and it's a great way of showing the horror side of things.
People don't even know about horror punk in the UK, and to see a band come on looking like zombies, playing music that we all know, and it'd just be such an eye-opener for people in the UK, and they might even book someone to play at the Sophie Tent next year.
Open
the Sophie Tent on a Thursday, when there's no bands playing, but people are camping.
That's the thing.
Why not?
Do you know what I mean? It's one of them things, it's like, there's so much horror out there, which is good music.
Can you get Graves down to do it?
Yeah, it's with different variations of music, but all within the compass of the world we call horror punk.
Yeah.
So,
we can compete.
Let me ask you a question, right? If you could encompass. Right. If you could encompass a band consisting of your favourite iconic horror movie characters, as in a four-piece band, bassist, guitarist, drummer, and singer, who would you have as them four people?
Rhythm.
Righto. Right, underrated.
You can think, that's your first question.
One of my favourite horror characters that never gets mentioned, Mick Taylor from Wolf Creek.
Oh.
I'd have him on vocals. He is a horrible bastard.
Nice.
He's a horrible fucking bastard.
Bastard.
You don't know where the fucking hell you've been. Leatherface, obviously.
What's he doing though?
Leatherface.
We had this.
He's got to be.
Guitar,
he's got to be on guitar. Ooh, yeah.
Chainsaw guitar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'd have Mick Taylor on vocals, Leatherface on guitar. Let's think, who could we have on drums? Tor Johnson.
Some fucking crazy motherfucker.
Tor Johnson. From Plan 9.
Nice.
That's a good call.
Yeah.
Why would you choose him on drums, Zoom Machine?
Because he's a big, burly fuck.
I think he could just
batter the shit out
of the drums.
Yeah, exactly. who would you have
on bass? And would it be a bass or a double bass?
Wow.
With horror, you've got the big double basses. You could do a big bastard.
Yeah. See, I've always said, I'd love to see Freddy Krueger.
Can you imagine that Frankenstein's monster with a double bass?
I'd love to see Freddy Krueger on a big double bass because he's got the four fingers. And he can be like, dum, 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 dum.
He could only play one note on his foot.
You know what I mean?
Frankenstein's monster double bass. Yeah,
that's synonymous.
Full size fucking 4x4 big motherfucker.
You look like Dave.
Yeah.
Tell me.
He looked like Frank and Fiend.
Yeah.
Frank and Fiend.
Rest in peace.
Are they not related, Frank and Fiend and Frankenstein's monster? I thought they were cousins or something.
We're all created from parts unknown.
Parts unknown.
Is that same, yeah. What, yes, same like, question to you. What
I did four ask characters that question. Would I you question.
Have?
Invisible Man on drums, just because it would look funny.
That'd be very good.
Thank you.
Just a set of sticks. Nice.
We need a female vocalist. We need to do the whole distillers.
No one's picked one yet.
Frankenhooker.
I was talking to my wife.
Frankenhooker.
I can
look at
any pants in my arm.
Hey,
what
about
a Frankenhooker
t-shirt?
Yeah, your
pizza. I was talking to my wife about a female singer.
Danny James!
She would like to see a female singer. And I was talking about either Thingy from Texas Chainsaw Massacre, because she screams a lot and spends the whole movie screaming.
Screams.
Same again, original Night of the Living Dead. She spends not the Savini remake, because the Savini remake made her a little bit tougher. But the original one, she spends like an hour and 10 minutes screaming.
I love that about a woman.
So why wouldn't she make a fantastic female
Linnea
singer?
Linnea Quigley on vocals.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Linnea Quigley. What's her name? Quigley.
You're right, love. Are you having a moment?
Yes.
He always has a moment.
Has a couple of moments. Yeah. Or Kerry.
Hybrid moments.
Because then when she's singing, all the blood could come down from nice. The... It would be atmospheric.
Yeah. I was waiting for you to say that. Yeah.
Be a bit like Marilyn Manson with the
thunder. There's a match that we need to see.
The theatrics with the blood.
Doing rain in blood.
That would be awesome. Yeah, just like... And it'll just...
Yeah.
Fall down.
Carrie and so John cool. Travolta doing a duet on Rain and Blood.
Also, we'd so watch that.
Driving to the prom in Christine.
We've lost him again.
Sorry, I was lost in that then for a second. That sounded sick. I was just going to say about reining it back to last weekend, the weekend before last, sorry, with the travelling morgue, and we didn't get to catch up with you during the duration of the show.
No.
What would it actually mean? What did it mean to you to play the Travelling Morgue again?
It was, to be fair, it was a fucking honour to be asked the second year on the trot.
Yeah.
It was nice. It was a hometown gig. We had a decent time slot. We sold a lot of merchandise, which is always nice because it means
the new t-shirts.
There's two new design t-shirts.
I think I spent like 30 quid on army merchandise.
But it's nice. It's like, for us as a band to sell that much merchandise before we even play the note.
It's nice.
Yeah. Nice feeling.
It's
better than a kick in the bollocks.
So for those of you who haven't got the They Came From Outer Space t-shirt, get your ass ones because they're badass.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's great to play it. I mean, Tommy Creep, Loop and Tooth, he's doing a fucking awesome job. He's putting on big gigs around the UK, supporting UK horror. He's getting bands out from Germany, and anything we can do to help him push that onwards and onwards and onwards, who knows where it'll be 5, 6, 7 years' time.
Wembley.
Yeah, well, that's it. I mean, all venues ground.
Yeah, there's a little pub on the corner called The Dog, it's great.
All venues start somewhere. Right.
So, while these two are here, who followed Army then?
He followed Army afterwards in the set.
The Ruined.
The Ruined. Gaz, this is your bag, isn't it? The Ruined,
Fucking great set.
Absolutely love them.
They were really good.
Really good. One of them bands that have been around for a long time, yet at the same time haven't been around recently.
No, it's a very burnt down.
They fucking came out, they kicked ass, really good. Enjoyed the lot, brilliant.
Well, it's like we know Sean in Army, the singer from The Ruined, because the first time the Crimson Ghost came over to the UK, Sean was singing for another band called The Rotten Forgotten, and they supported us in the Army, who supported the Crimson Ghost in Blackpool. And that's where we first met Sean.
First talked up with him,
So it was nice seeing Sean again in his other band.
Really nice guys. So we did it in
How long have they been together then? Because
they've been together for a while.
I think The Ruined have been together a lot longer than anyone knows.
Yeah.
I heard around about the time I discovered you lot.
Really?
Yeah.
This had probably been late 2009. Is that when you guys started?
What are we in now? 16. We started, about 2009. First gig was 2010.
You put that first song on Night of the Wolf, late 2009. And that's when I found it. It was a brand new. I was just literally doing the standard horror punk in the UK YouTube search, trying to find new bands. Oh, well, there's Army. Oh, they're from Mimi and Night of the Wolf. And so around about the same time, I discovered The Ruin and found out they had a big discography. So that was, 7 years ago?
Yeah, they've been around since a long time. So, after The Ruined, who did we have?
I remember, if I've missed anyone out, I feel like shit if I've missed anyone, because I'm not necessarily doing this in order, and there's probably someone we've missed out, but I remember...
Dead
13, not yet.
Dead 13.
Who we accidentally missed off on our review. Not review, but our build-up. Last time when we were looking at bands playing, not intentional that we missed Dead 13 out, and I feel like a dick for missing them out. I even read something to say about them which was really positive, but I just literally, I'm blind and I missed it off the fucking queue.
You're positive about nobody. You're a horrible bastard.
I'm evil.
Evil.
You're evil. Disgusting.
But they were good.
fucking brilliant. Dead Pigeons.
Sometimes we do end up getting wrapped in some of the interviews we had to do and stuff. And
by wrapped in, it means pissed.
Yeah. But yeah. We did the ruined interview, and obviously that ran into. We caught some of it, but not as much as we wanted. I saw
most of Dead Dead Scene, and they're a big draw, aren't they? Big audience, because they're appealing to a lot of people.
They were awesome.
A lot of casual fans weren't necessarily into the horror punk. No Dead 13, and with the disposal of the said bands like the Defiled that aren't around anymore, a similar fan base. I'm not saying they're the same music, I'm not saying it's the same thing, but I'm saying there is a slight connection and a relatively similar fan base. And I just think it's that sort of people that is a big audience, and there's a big audience and a big draw for them there. And I mean, they've got songs on Kerrang, and they're
in my opinion, you have the two big names that are on most posters, most banners, most everything else, and that's Army and Gravedale.
Yeah.
In my, you know what
I mean? One or the other.
Personally, to be above them on a card means you've got to be something.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And what I see of them, two or three songs, really enjoyed. They had a great presence on stage, and they knew how to work a crowd and stuff. So after them, who do we have?
Is that The Fright?
It was The Fright. My only thing I would say is that to people that were just casually coming and buying tickets from online and turning up on the day, it appeared like it was advertised as The Fright was the headliner.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people left after The Fright thinking Dr. Hell had already played, because they didn't know who Dr. Hell were, and they didn't know who Dead 13 were. They thought it was the band that had just played, so they left after The Fright, which was a shame. Again, sets being cut short, sucked. That couldn't be helped. That's nobody's fault.
Yeah.
Mother was amazing.
Mother was amazing.
I mean, if you watched the last podcast, you would have seen their version of Mother. That whole place, song. It was fucking brilliant.
Big shout out to Lon and Kane, you two. We adore you guys. It's really, really good. And again, it's my kind of thing. I love my metal, my gothic music, and 69 Eyes. And Absolutely Paradise Lost. Really, really good. They played the songs that I like. Their new album, I think it's Rising Beyond or something like that, is called. And they played songs off that, which I love. I was very inebriated and very drunk, in case you can't tell from the last podcast. I spent £110 at the bar and on your merchandise. And
Jesse Bones.
Jesse Bones.
Again.
And
he bought Jesse Bones.
Can't get rid of him.
He's for sale.
So after The Fright, the headline. How you doing, Mark? How are you?
I'm still standing.
Stage invasion.
Even after the invasion. Smile, you're on camera.
Say hello.
Hello.
Quick question, what's your favourite horror movie of all time?
Jesus,
That's a biblical one! You do look a bit like
House of Haunted Hill.
Original House of Haunted Hill.
Original.
You heard it from there from Uncle Mark, Original House of Haunted Hill.
Crucifixion.
You take it easy, dude?
Yeah.
Speak to you in a bit.
You've got
everything on the film needs. There we go. So.
The Fright, we're just saying. Again, it sounds like I've been really overly positive about everybody, but we're not kissing everybody's ass for the sake of it. Everybody was legitimately really good. There's a man. The Fright shall not pass. Were the band I was most looking forward to seeing. And
you shall not pass!
Sweet. Uh-huh.
Security!
I haven't got staff.
We haven't
either. But, I don't know what else to say about The Fright. I want them back over onto a longer set. I want them to do their set.
Staff.
Because to me, the set that The Fright did wasn't their set. It was a very quick, very rushed version of their set. And I know people that live in Germany have said that they do a much longer, much better set, more songs, better songs. And everything they did was great, but it just wasn't enough of it. And Gaz, would you say that's the case? Yeah.
That's exactly it, my man.
You wait till you see this tomorrow. You're going to
laugh.
They were
amazing, though. They were so good.
The Fright.
My favourite band.
Yeah. Too
short,
so,
but it
after
was
The Fright,
we had Dr. Hell.
We had Dr. Hell.
And the thing about
Dr. Hell, Dr. Hell were awesome.
Circus Punk.
Yeah.
I mean, we got took up a lot of time with The Fright interview, but I went...
Jaja Britain!
Ace in there.
Did you say, where's my syringe?
Yeah.
That sounds bad on camera.
Yeah,
that sounds good on camera. I'm full of injections.
So where's my spoon?
And then we've got some simple water and lighter.
Not that we're advocating this.
We used to buy Kit Kats, but...
So, anyway, Dr. Fright.
Oh,
Lord. Jesus Christ.
So, Dr. Fright.
Dr. Fright. Go on, Dr. Fright.
Who the fuck is Dr. Fright?
It's Dr. Fright. Dr. Hell. Dr. Fright? We've got a super
group.
This is fucking awesome.
Dr. One thing I'd like to say about
Dr. Helms. I see, I got confused because Gandalf come fucking walking in here.
Who the right? Fuck was that?
And was then we started to
recite. It wasn't fucking Jesse Burns. Yeah.
Long Chaney singing for the Bright.
It was literally. That was near enough the Christmas special right there.
Ghost of Christmas fucking past.
The ghost but anyway, of anyone with long grey hair. Right?
Getting back to what I was talking about.
Back in the day.
Dr. Hell.
Yeah! Okay. Right. One thing that I thought was very noticeable going back to an after party afterwards was that a lot of people hadn't heard of Dr. Hell going in. He weren't avid horror enthusiasts. But
I went to an after party
with Gorgeous Morgue, whose EP release is on, I think it's the 24th.
Gorgeous Morgue, really,
yeah. Yeah, Gorgeous Morgue, 24th of June is their EP launch in Sheffield, if anyone wants to come. Recommend it. But
promote away, don't worry about it.
Seeing Gorgeous Morgue in person, I'd say they're kind of mediocre looking morgue.
Yeah.
Oh, mediocre morgue.
I don't want to say gorgeous because that's only one corpses only.
And fans.
So, family. Right.
No, but
family.
Yeah,
so you still want to talk
family.
About the Gorgeous
Morgue? No, I want to say what people at that party were saying is that people hadn't heard of Dr. Hell before they went in yet. When everyone went in wanting to see Dead 13 or wanting to see the fight or wanting to see bands that are on the lineup or wanting to see nobody you hadn't heard of anybody.
All day long, Dr. Hell everybody, was nothing but fucking awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, but the thing is, everybody left talking about Dr. Hell. They were the headline act for a reason. Everybody left singing Dr. Hell songs. We went back afterwards and it was all singing the Dr. Hell songs. And we were saying, like, oh, who did you enjoy? Everyone's like, that last band, what were they called? And I was like, oh, it's Dr. Hell. And I was like, oh, God, I've got to get the new album. I've got to get Drunken Zombies. I'd never heard of them. They were really good. They got the crowd in the palm of their hand. They were really, really interactive, very punky, very in your face. Really, really, really catchy songs. And people who didn't know the songs before really, really took it on board. Everybody afterwards was talking about Dr. Hell. And I think that's really, really good for a band of people that were casual fans hadn't heard of to be talking about afterwards.
Things we do.
Is really, really positive. And you were just saying about what they were like before they came on.
I was about to go on the crowd machine, to be honest with you.
But what he was going to say is that we were with them the whole day, drinking and talking, and they were the nicest guys you could ever imagine.
Yeah, they honestly got they were.
The merch guy was lovely as well.
The merch guy was a fucking dude. The merch guy.
Traveling Morgue Roundup. I'm going to go and grab people at random and quickly bring them back here for two questions. Right? Here comes Gandalf again.
Yeah. I just want to say that my favourite band of the day were Dead Stiff.
Santa's had a beating. Yeah.
Have you heard of him before?
Right.
I saw a quick sign off.
Oh, big thing.
In 2 seconds.
Right. This is a quick sign off.
So, we're back again. And Dead 13 podcast. And we're here with a couple of friends. Some would say family. We're going to ask them a few questions. In fact, we're going to ask them all the same questions. And we have two questions for them all. These aren't horror punk fans. They're not fans of the music, but everybody's a fan of horror movies in general.
Is it worth saying most people who are wrestling or wrestlers aren't they?
Are you a bunch of wrestlers?
You interrupted me.
Who's going
to take two? Sometimes, I tell you what, working with that guy is unbelievable. Right, okay. So, let's go. Right, first of all,
Arit.
My man Mario here. Right, so what we're going to do is we're going to start with what is your favourite horror movie of all time? If you could pick one horror movie,
just pick one.
What would you pick?
It would be Friday the 13th, without a shadow of a doubt.
Part one.
Yeah. Relevant date as well.
Yes. Today is Friday the 13th.
This is Friday the 13th, so that was a a good idea to pick that for today. So I know Marion, I've known him for 20 years, and I know that's his favourite movie. This is my man Scott, again, I've known this man for so long. What is your favourite movie?
Hellraiser 1.
That's two ones.
I've met Clive Barker.
My main man Jim here. Jim, what is your favourite horror movie?
Wreck.
Oh, the camera one, the first put. Is it Spanish?
Original.
Yeah, really good.
Original, man.
I've only ever seen the Spanish one, but dude, put it there. Wreck, the Spanish. Nice, very good.
It's good when we get things outside the box. And finally,
Mr. J.
You got to take the video outside the box and put it in the player and watch it.
For some reason, won't tag me.
Tag.
What is your.
I'm going to go with John Carpenter's Halloween 1.
Nice! Very nice.
One of my favourites. Love that film.
So, next question. If you guys could create a band consisting of any horror movie characters you guys wanted, i.e. a four-piece band, as in a bassist, a guitarist, a singer, and a drummer, who would you put in said position?
Definitely Michael Myers as lead singer.
Then he's such a bad
character. He's like that.
Yeah. The band is called Silent But Deadly. Oh,
Silent Horror.
Silent Horror. Exactly. Oh. Anyone?
No.
Well,
So if you've got Michael Myers as your...
So that's your singer, you spoil the rest.
So who are the other three?
I'm not very good with bands and that, but I guess if I...
You know what a drummer is.
I know what a drummer is.
You know what a guitarist is.
I probably have to put, is it Jigsaw from Saw? Is that his name, Jigsaw? Yeah.
Billy is the puppet.
Yeah,
Jigsaw
just
is
he looks
the
like
man.
He could be wound up to play the drums.
Billy is the puppet.
Like a little monkey.
He looks like he could be wound up to play the drums. What's the other parts of a band?
A bass player.
Oh, Freddy, because he's got the fucking claws. He could fucking...
Hold! You see, you tell this man's my tag partner, because I've said that on, like, what, three podcasts so far? And he didn't know that yet, still said it. Freddy, bass.
Yeah, see, he's got the fucking claws.
He's got the four claws, four strings.
Are we allowed to swear on this, by the way?
Huh?
Are we allowed to swear?
Say what the fuck you want.
Fucking ape, son. I'm so fucked,
ain't I? You fucking swear, you cunt.
What's the next one?
Do not say fuck all, brother.
Guitarist?
Fucking guitarist!
Oh, man. Probably Leatherface then. I have to go.
Gandalf's back.
Only because I saw the figure down there. You'd have to show them the figure so they know.
Claws already got the camera. Already.
So that's your four.
That's my four.
Right, Jim. Who would be your four?
My taxi's here.
You say easy, Gandalf.
You too, sir.
Merry Christmas.
Bye.
Sleeping bag.
Nice to meet you.
We'll get you later.
Hello, Unky.
Quick kiss.
Santa's off.
See you on your birthday.
Lovely to meet you, my friend. I'll see you on your birthday.
This
you
is will.
You're going to regret inviting me.
You surely not.
While he's here, ask him his favourite horror movie.
I've already asked him.
What's your favourite horror movie?
House on Haunted Hill.
House on Haunted Hill.
Nice choice. You take this advice.
See you later.
He is the next.
See you later. Bones.
See you all soon.
See you later.
So,
have a good one.
What's yours?
I think pretty much the same as Danny's, apart from I'd have the drummer as the screen face, just because of the face.
And I did that on drums with the fucking.
Yeah. I just, you know.
Yeah.
Just for a bit of comedy in there.
Nice. So, Scott, what's
Come on, sleeping bag.
Right. Sleeping bag.
On drums?
Yeah.
The mechanic from Hellraiser.
Oh, man.
Extra arms.
Nice. Yeah.
You get some awesome beats going on.
Yeah.
I think I'd have Michael Myers on bass.
Yeah?
Big, strong, rhythmic.
Yeah, you like that top.
You'd like to sleep with him in the night.
Yeah. I would also then have on lead guitar Charisma. I like the dude from Shocker.
Nice! Nice choice, Horace Tinker.
Yes, Horace Pinker.
Horace Pinker.
Yes.
Horace Pinker.
And the band could be called One in the Pinker, Two in the Stinker.
One in the Horace Pinker. I'm using that.
Vocals. Oh, Pinhead. And go sort of gothic with it.
Nice to talk.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's got the wall.
He's got some nice lines.
Yeah.
Tell him, Mario, what is your?
Okay, well, I think on drums, I'm going to have to go for Jason Voorhees, I know, because I had to put Jason in there, and he's a big motherfucker who can, like,
you're
really...
You don't say much, but he can drill.
Hammer. Yeah, that's the thing, you know what I mean? He can really fucking hammer.
Yeah.
As far as on the old guitar, I know it's not technically a horror film, but there's horror connotations to it. And I think that it's still scary as fuck in a lot of ways. But the little banjo kid from Deliverance.
What a fucking answer. That's awesome.
You know what I mean?
I love that. That's brilliant. I thought you were going to say Kermit the Frog.
Or Sonic the Hedgehog. Yeah.
I have a little Nick sitting there.
It's back the way you came.
On bass. Do you know what? I think that we could, because he's a bit old school, where he's the time period that he's originally from. So I think that you can get some really good rhythmic tones out of Candyman.
Yeah,
he's got
Candyman would
be
nice as a singer.
He's got the hook though.
It'd be really cool.
See, on vocals,
he could slide.
He could.
Yeah, now he can. Yeah, see, anytime he wants to.
On vocals, I really like female voices. I like female singers.
We've got into this a few times. A handful of people have said this.
Right, and I think I've got an interesting one. I think I've got one that you're going to like.
Go on.
Right? Reagan from The Exorcist.
Because,
for a couple of reasons. A few reasons, actually. First of all, she's got her own, you know, innocent little girl voice. But then she's also got the fucking demon voice as well. So just
your
like...
Your cocks in hell!
Just like
and
Corey
can,
from fucking Slipknot.
Fucking get the crowd.
Yeah. Just like Corey from Slipknot, she's got range.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic.
Plus...
What? That's fucking awesome.
Plus, when she's in the bed and she's like... Bitch can headbang.
Yeah.
Right?
Among
and
other things.
Things like... Your mother sucks cocks in hell, and let Jesus fuck you. You know, these are good names.
Standard
songs.
Metal songs, aren't they? Yeah.
I think that Linda Blair and the Exorcists would be a good fucking band.
Awesome.
What else can you say to that?
Yeah.
I really enjoy this. I think we should have another horror question.
You want another horror question?
Yeah.
Right. See, I've got to come up with the questions here now.
You know what you're saying.
You can always edit it anyway.
What about a thing that made us jump?
Okay, all right.
What made you jump?
Yeah.
In your biggest
reach. Jason's mother.
In the same sense, it's kind of a what's your favourite horror movie. But what, as a child, what was the one horror movie that made you fucking shit yourself?
Halloween. Fuck.
Are we going in order or
whatever.
Back order or...
Whoever goes first.
You fucking
we'll start, with, we'll start with you, sir, then.
For me, I've said this fucking too many times. I was off school when I was young, and I went to the DVD cabinet, and I was looking through, and it was like the only movie I've seen.
DVDs when you were young?
I'm only 25.
He's a whippersnapper.
I'm only 25.
Wait till he tells his story.
Yeah. It's in a picture house. And then I'll search him through, and the only film I'd not seen the entire collection was a film called The Exorcist. Blah, blah, blah. Watched it, didn't bother me. That following night, I went to bed, and I was like, oh my fucking God. And I've watched everything ever since, and that felt with Linda Blair, it's done nothing to it. The way I felt that first night, I was fuck me, and I was like absolutely bothered by it. Every other film I've watched ever since has done nothing, but that first time I watched that, I put it back in the cabinet going, that was shite. But that following night, fucking
hell.
When my own fucking mind took over it. Jesus. If I ever met Linda Blair, I think it'd piss me pants.
She's lovely.
She's lovely.
Yeah, she would be. But the only thing is, though, I'll go up to her and I'll do the normal thing and she can sign anything for me. She'll give me that look and I'll go,
shit. I remember she did pictures for us just for putting some money in charity
box. Yeah, that's really good.
Yeah,
so
really
then
nice.
Lucas, who's yours then?
Like I shouted out earlier before my turn as usual. My parents, I guess,
your parents made you
shit. That's not what's scared me. They didn't really they didn't really get like certificates on things because I was Terminator and RoboCop at a really young age. I'm wearing a Frankenhooker t-shirt, which my mum taped off TV for me when I was like five, assuming it was like a children's thing. And my mum let me watch Halloween.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, my mum let me watch Halloween when I was seven. And I couldn't watch it the way through, and I had to sleep with the light. I was scared of the dark, and I was a little shitty, scared kid. And dad just... nightmares.
Terrified the shit.
Absolutely terrified. Mum, there's someone on the hallway. Mum, can you turn the light on?
It's your Uncle Rob.
Yeah. That's called Rob. I was like, literally, I had big curtains in my bed, I had a big window, and I thought there was someone at the window. And just nightmares. And just kept me on.
So then,
failed school because of that film.
What's made you shit yourself the most?
I'm gonna go with my pick, the original Halloween, the John Carpenter one.
That's what I meant, yeah.
The scene that scares me and still kind of creeps me out to this day, but I'm an adult now. The scene where Jamie Lee looks out the window for the first time and the bed sheets are bellowing and you see Michael. That shit, I did never look out my fucking bedroom window after that.
You'll never hang up washing
and
again.
The thing is,
he hasn't washed it.
To his mum's chagrin.
Obviously, you guys have more knowledge than I do about this stuff. We had a VHS and it had Michael on the front cover. The original Halloween, it had Michael on it. And me and my mate Chris, we had this, and we got to watch this. And we used to pause it and try to play the game Spot Michael, because at some point, you know, she'd look out the window.
We had a hedge.
And the camera shots were so far away.
You couldn't see where he was.
So we would pause it, and old tracking and everything, and like, there he is. Is that him? And that followed on through every Halloween we watched. I remember one in Halloween 4, when he's chasing his niece. Yep. Is it Jamie?
Yeah.
Danny Harris.
And there's a bit where a sheriff's just sat there. I think he's on a rocking chair.
Yeah.
And we could never make out, because it was a VHS copy of that as well, if it was his like a bit of his lip or the whole mask, but you saw a flash of white in the background of that shot. Stuff like that still haunts me to this fucking day. Like seeing Michael, like, oh fuck, he's there. Fucking so you can't tell the telly, do you know what I mean? That it's there.
So Jim, what was your most scariest film you remember that makes you still to this day you think, I'm not scared of it now, but I still have that little part of me that's like,
ugh. So you said when you were like younger, and I was thinking about was it's not even a horror film, man. Like Never Ending Story.
I was waiting for someone to say water shit down.
Right.
That's fucking tough.
I bought that for my niece last week. She's 5 years old.
She loves it.
She hasn't seen it yet.
Never Ending Story, when you're quite young, when the horse in the quicksand.
Vortex.
And you just see his face, like, and you're like, no.
It's unpleasant.
It's like being in the cinema and watching Spike watching Optimus Prime die, and you're like, no!
Don't talk about that now!
Hold back the tweets!
It's the horse's face.
Yeah.
That you see, like,
why did he have to die?
You see it going, you do get that animation. I am fucked.
You're like, kicking the balls. Can I jump in before Jim goes again as well? I know I mentioned as a child the Michael Myers thing scaring the shit out of me. There's, I don't know if you've got, I'm sure you guys have watched it. Is it The Strangers, where a couple go to a house,
a wedding? They remade it over the last couple of years.
I think it was the remake. They knock on the door, random. But the bit that scared me the most of that was the fact that this cat looked like Scarecrow from the Nolan films.
Yeah.
Just with a bag on his head.
Yeah.
But there was no music that scared you. The camera panned and he was just there. And I think it scared me more the fact that there was no music or no...
It's like the shot in Nightbreed where the kid looks down the stairs and sees the doctor at the bottom with the sack on his head. And there's nothing, and he just looks up at the kid.
That's an adult.
Just like
haunting.
That clip from The Strangers as an adult, like shit me up. Like, oh fuck, like someone's in there.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's just my 2 cents.
I would say though that recently, or maybe jump. I'm gonna go back to it. Wreck. Yeah. When the body just drops from the top of the...
That's fucking... Yeah.
You're just like... Because that feels real. Like, yeah. I know, like, you know, knives, chainsaws, whatever. But that feels like any time.
Yeah.
And then... You know, you read about the film, and it's like, yeah, we didn't tell the actors, we just dropped this body on the natural reaction.
They shot themselves.
Yeah.
Because you do find it some ways to do that. I remember when Gunnar Hansen told us the story about, the three of us, weren't it? We met Gunnar Hansen. And he told us the story about the actors weren't allowed to see him in the Leatherface costume. So when they were first shown Leatherface, their reaction was realistic, and it was fucking great. So,
go on, Scott.
Sleeping bag? American
Werewolf
in London.
You took my...
The transformation
that's
scene.
My fucker.
Company Werewolf in London.
I know what he's going to say, and he's going to have my will, isn't he?
When I first saw it, it was on BBC.
Nazi Werewolf.
Yeah, me too.
Through the window.
12 years old.
Yeah.
I was like, what's this? This sounds scary.
I was watching it with my parents, and yeah, it got to the Nazi Werewolf scene.
Oh, the flashback, the dream.
Went through that, they switched channel. We finished off with our pizza. Nightmares for three nights.
The greatest werewolf film of all time, and it's truly
by far.
Perhaps the best film of all time. Perhaps the best film of all time.
I don't even need to go because he's just told my same exact thing. Is that it's that scene where the Nazi werewolves come through the thing, or when I was a kid, it was the. Jaws, where the fucking face comes up at the window. I mean, brilliant.
It's very telling that scene because obviously Marianne. David Kessler is a Jewish character, isn't he? And the Nazis come through and massacre his family.
Yeah. I don't think they're
Nazis. It's horrifying. Absolutely horrifying.
And still is.
Yeah, it is. Honestly, that movie is one of the greatest.
And it makes you fucking jump.
It's phenomenal. It's still to this day stands true. Yeah. That werewolf transformation scene is...
Best transformation. I love transformation
and
scenes.
And the chase in the underground.
And, do you know what I mean? Which is what made Michael Jackson go, I need that shit in my life, and therefore we got Thriller. So, Mario, let's end it up with what you think.
The film that scared me the most when I was a kid was the film that made me into a horror fan, and that's Nightmare on Elm Street 3.
Yes. Dream Warriors!
Is
that Dream Warriors!
Is that the one where they're in the care home?
Yes.
Fucking arguably like the best film in the series. as much as I love number one.
Easily the best.
Oh, I love it. I went to a Halloween party. It was a friend's Halloween party. And I must have been about like fucking 9 years old. And this was on Sky Movies, and I was hiding behind my mate's mum because I was shitting myself. And I was so embarrassed that I was so scared that weekend I was like, no, fuck that, I need to get over my fear. And I turned around to my mum and said, look,
can I hide behind you?
I was like, can you rent a video for me? She's like, yeah, what do you want? I was like, Nightmare on Elm Street, any of the Nightmare on Elm Streets, doesn't matter which one it is. And she came back with Freddy's Dead, The Final Nightmare, which is fucking hilarious and not scary at all.
No, it's more of a parody,
like,
isn't it?
Where you were like,
Tom McCall and you vocal in that film.
Yeah, so I watched that and that was it. And it got me over my fear, and that's how I started watching horror movies. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
That's
awesome.
Well, thank you very much, you four.
Let's go listen to Docking now.
In the show.
Oh, dude, this, I think you should do more.
Maybe tonight.
Is there anything else?
Maybe tonight, Juby, go.
Anything you can pick up?
Luke Skywalker.
Out there
somewhere. We'll grab Neil next.
Yeah?
Neil of Fortune.
Right. We're going to pause for 2 seconds and we'll be right back after these brief commercial episodes.
Well, the same to the rest of us.
Right, we're back again. This time with our friend Neil.
Neil of Fortune.
Neil of Fortune.
I've been waiting for ages to get Neil on here. Will you clear off?
One of our closest friends, one of our family members.
Horror family.
Glad to be here, guys.
Fucking Adam.
Good to have you on here, Neil.
You're fucking
scarred, dog. Didn't like it with the mask.
I got freaking.
God.
I think you're going to have to redo this.
No.
No. I've cut the camera.
It's called uncut in the book. We don't cut.
Uncut shit.
Go on then, Jason.
That was my annoying dog getting in the fucking way.
Oh, she's so cute.
That's very
cute. Just like that cigarette is. Right. So, I'll start over again. This is our friend Neil. Say hello, Neil.
Hello, Neil.
Oh, fucking hell.
AKA Neil before Zod.
Yeah. I like Neil of Fortune.
There is no Neil.
That was fucking brilliant.
Neil.
Right. So anyway, right. We're going to ask you what you asked everybody else, right? But saying that, but you are into the horror music side of things, and like other people we've had on today. So, let's break the questions down. Top three horror bands, i.e. psychobilly, punk, metal, anything you want.
Anything you like.
What are your top three bands?
We'll go for psycho ones, right?
Yeah?
Okay, Demented I'll go. There's got to be one top or a funky type psycho bands. Sick as shit.
Yeah, really live, they're fucking amazing.
Fucking amazing. Sparky is just weird.
Mental.
And mental, yeah. Coffee Cats.
Oh, fuck yeah. Yeah. In my first opinion, one of the best psychobilly bands out there. Love the Coffee Cats.
Cartoon video, on the internet.
I suppose the ones that started off was the Meteors, really. Yeah. The Psychoness with Michael Myers.
Yeah.
It's an awesome track. Michael Myers, they're back again. It's just an amazing track. It really is.
So, on the subject of horror, what would you say was your favourite horror movie of all time? That you can watch over and over and over and you never get bored of?
I used to like The Dead Zone. Years back.
Yeah.
The Dead Zone?
Yeah.
That's where we found him.
Yeah.
Christopher Walken.
I'm trying to send him back as well.
Yeah, Christopher Walken, yeah.
No, it's just like the 80s films really for me, it's just like 80s is where it was at, you know what I mean, horror movie wise, not even that movie wise, cartoon wise, everything with 80s.
As a part of Americana in the 80s, there was like Scooby-Doo, you had everything just in your face. Late 70s,
early
80s.
Scary.
It was in late 70s, early 80s, it was in your face, scary. Horror was there.
No, I'll tell you what was scary when I was growing up was Doctor Who.
Doctor Who.
Okay,
yeah. That is a perfect segue.
No, the 70s one.
Into the questions we were asking other people earlier on. Right?
It's like, fuck it, oh.
What was the one movie, / TV series, like you just said, that just made you shit yourself? And still to this day, you will watch, you will go, I know now as an adult, but when I was a kid, you still get that.
It probably was, the first thing was Doctor Who with John Pertwee as Doctor Who.
Yeah, my favourite Doctor.
He was the third. What did it look like?
Blonde hair.
Wurzel Brummage.
Okay, I know.
Not Cat Weasel. But no, they were scary then. Yeah. The '70s, and I thought the '70s were fucking scary anyway, really.
It's too much orange and brown.
That was a scary bit, yeah. I always wore orange and brown. It was like Dun & Co all over.
So, right, we've been asking everybody the same question, right? If you could set up a band consisting of four people, lead singer, your drummer, a guitarist and your bassist.
Oh, Jesus Christ, yeah.
And all had to be iconic horror movie characters or any character that has been in a horror movie or something along that sort of line. Who would that be? We've had some fucking fantastic fucking answers.
It's got like, for moroseness, I'll have Myers on vocals.
Joy Division-esque, because one thing Michael Myers does is project joy.
Well, they were Joy Division in its original concept was a whorehouse in Nazi Germany, so there we go.
The Joy Division were was the 1930s, late 1930s.
Yeah. In Nazi Germany. Well, we can't get much more horror than that.
No, you can't really. No.
It wasn't pleasant, really, was it?
I still think you've got to have Animal on drums. So.
Animal on drums, yeah. Fantastic.
Oh, from the Muppets?
Yes. Yeah.
No.
Lucas on drums.
Fucking Animal on Muppets.
So, who would you put on bass then?
Bass.
Could be
standout
bass.
Yeah.
Mm. Ooh. Do you know what? I've got a damn good one.
King Kong. He'd look awesome with a double bass.
Oh, well, one big finger.
King Kong with a double bass.
That's a big fucking.
Is Kong Kong. When you have just one massive bass
the size of the skyscraper, like
Empire State Building the size of bass.
Okay, on lead guitar.
You can have a bass off.
The creature,
yeah.
And it's
King Kong.
Yeah. Bass off
Basil. Well, I do love the old horror flicks. Like, yeah. That's one thing I do love. Like, the old horror flicks.
What, classic horror, well, universal horror flicks?
Classic horror flicks. Yeah.
I love, so I love out of the out of universal horror movies.
Universal
then.
Black and white.
Who's,
yeah.
Who's your favourite universal character?
Oh, that's got to be Frank.
Yeah.
Mr. and Mrs. F.
They've got, yeah. They're
a doctor.
Yeah. They are. Seen as the face of Universal.
The films then were brilliant.
Yeah.
Just like,
I watched them the other night and I fucking cannot get enough of them. Yeah.
Very camp, isn't
Carl,
it?
Carl off playing any role, really.
Yeah, everything
was doing fucking awesome.
That sequel, The Bride, is such a camp.
The thing is that fucked off the most. Yeah, fucking dead
Wolfman films I used to love as well. The early
Wolfman versus Frankenstein, yeah. Where the bird that goes in there.
Yeah. With the roll neck.
I just want to say it's 1:38.
We are 1:38! We are 1:38!
So, on that note, we're going to call it quits.
On 1:38 at night?
Yeah.
Cheers, machine.
Give him a wave, Robbie. I'll sign it off.
Well, that's another one done for us, meads. So, sign off, shall
once
we?
Once again, Undead 13, we're reporting from a house party on Friday the 13th. Wrapping up the travelling morgues, having a laugh with some of the guests here. Most of them are wrestling fans, not horror fans, but they've all given their 2 cents on the horror scene,
fuck,
haven't they?
Yeah, yeah, it's been a good fucking night.
It's just been a really, really fun day. We're just literally three fans who are into horror music, having a laugh, having a drink, and we've all had a really good time.
Once done it again.
Once again.
We did it again.
Spread the horror, me out.
Spread the horror.
Fucking out.